Hi guys, welcome to our YouTube channel. Want to know the best Metroidvania games on Nintendo Switch to play in 2024? Then let's take a look at this video. Those who are looking for a less complex and more toned-down Souls-like game with faster exploration have plenty of options to choose from, but that kind of defeats the purpose. We want to feel the satisfaction that comes from losing to the same OP boss attack that gives a quarter-second warning before wiping out most of our health. So we come to Eldorand. In a far-off mystical land, some bad stuff is going down, bro, and you've got to sort it all out. A dark and deadly cult that may be masquerading as a religious order is extending its influence across a once beautiful land, leading to animals becoming hostile, monsters coming out of the woodwork, and people facing certain doom. Get your washed-up warrior looking a way you like, and then venture forth swinging all sorts of weapons, throwing all sorts of projectiles, mastering useful magic, and finding the most in-stylish armor to eliminate the cult's VIP guest list. Though it had a shaky launch, this game has found a comfortable place as a portable platformer. You are a local witch who has had her mail stolen for unknown reasons that appear to be linked to several strange occurrences in the natural world. It's a personal quest, but you may as well figure out what's going on and punch some big bad bosses back into line to get some clues. While running and jumping, you'll need to alternate what magic you have to solve the problems and enemies of the day. Some games are so mysterious that even after playing them for hours, you still don't know entirely what's going on. Trying to explain Ghost Song in one sentence to someone is like trying to stuff an entire cheeseburger in your mouth. It sounds possible, but you really should think twice about it. This sci-fi story follows an unusual robotic being that may or may not be a living machine or a literal ghost in a shell. But what you do know is that the place you've arrived at is anything but safe. While exploring, you'll encounter a variety of strange and twisted creatures that you aren't sure were born like this or recently became such. They are blocking your way to old technology and hidden treasures that will make your body more functional and formidable. So you'll just have to power through to find the answers.
Or I'll defend myself.
Robots evoke a very distinct image in the brain, and it's unlikely to be an adorable one. That being said, many games have cute and friendly looking robot characters, which makes us want to get to know them all the more. The SteamWorld series has mastered this, and SteamWorld Dig 2 follows up from an enjoyable introduction to its universe. It's a universe where robots are the dominant sentient species, so it takes place in the future. Either way, you are playing the plucky pigtailed Dorothy, who sets out to mine into the depths to find Rusty, the hero of the previous game. This means you'll be doing a lot of creative digging, gathering as many minerals as possible, upgrading your abilities, discovering new tools and gear, as well as uncovering things long forgotten. Gato Roboto is unique in many ways. Firstly, the game is monochromatic, chunky, and gorgeous. Secondly, you play a cat in a big suit, stomping around, blasting enemy robots, and slowly uncovering a deceptively large and fiendishly designed maze is only part of the fun here. When you aren't trundling about in your suit, you are scampering around like a house cat. Your mobility is enhanced considerably, but the trade-off is instant death if an enemy catches you. It adds an element of cat and mouse gameplay that helps break up the game nicely. Nintendo and Microsoft like to give off the impression that they are best buddies. One of the ways they've showcased this is with Ori and the Blind Forest, a former Xbox exclusive. Interesting backstory aside, Ori and the Blind Forest is a seriously good game worth picking up. Ori is less focused on combat and much more on smooth platforming and mobility. This adds a unique layer of difficulty not always found in the genre. This game also has a powerful story that will cause even the sternest of gamers to break down into fits of tears. All of this is supported by stunning visuals and an evocative soundtrack. There's an equally fantastic sequel ready to play too. Guacamelee is rather unique in its approach to tackling the genre. Instead of large maps littered with enemies, this game keeps its combat restricted to small beat-em-up sections that give Juan a place to unleash the power of the luchador. You will punch, kick, and throw enemies in over-the-top wrestling combos before returning to the world to do some light platforming. As disjointed as this may sound, the game pulls it off wonderfully. It's also filled with tongue-in-cheek humor, references, and jabs at the genre as a whole. Guacamelee is also set in Mexico, and uses this unique setting to great effect. It even has a sequel worth checking out. Axiom Verge wears its inspiration on its sleeve, at least visually. It has this moist, viscous aesthetic that is highly reminiscent of the original Metroid. Weird globules litter the environment, and everything just looks bioorganic. It's sickeningly beautiful to behold. It's also a damn good game, expertly meshing combat, platforming, and exploration with a nice mix of weapons and traversal upgrades. Axiom Verge does stand out. There's even an interesting narrative that helps tie everything together into a mystery begging to be uncovered. Metroid may have started the genre, and Super might have perfected it, but Castlevania carried the torch during Metroid's two-decade nap. The Castlevania Advance Collection compiles some of the best Metroidvanias from the 2000s, and it even throws in Vampire Kiss, Dracula X for good measure. Being Game Boy Advance titles, none of these games pack the visual fidelity found in modern Metroidvanias, however, have a timeless art style and kick-ass music. More importantly, the games still hold up in the gameplay department, with only Circle of the Moon feeling a little bit clunky from time to time. This is still a fantastic package, and every game here is worth experiencing. Blasphemous may be the most disturbing game on this list. Visually and narratively, the game is incredibly explicit in its dark depiction of Catholicism. It may be stomach-turning at times, but this gothic horror is steeped in what can only be described as genuine love and respect for its source. It's also stunningly beautiful despite all of this. As is to be expected, a game with a theme this strong isn't going to be easy. It takes a few notes from the Dark Souls school of design, giving Blasphemous a unique blend of mechanics and systems. Combat, visuals, and sound design were the focus here, and while there are plenty of secrets to be found and platforms to be mounted, they take a bit of a backseat. Hollow Knight is one of those games that sticks with you long after you stop playing it. Simple yet refined combat, a beautifully realized world, and fascinating lore manage to make a game about insects surprisingly compelling. The game is very hard, however. Unlike every other Metroidvania around, even mapping the world can be a challenge in Hollow Knight, so a firm sense of direction, keen reflexes, and a willingness to die are required to succeed. The game even has buckets of free DLC that will put even the most veteran players to the test. Super Metroid is where the genre took off. It perfectly combines combat, exploration, and more importantly, freedom. Added with a sprinkle of horror, it creates one of the most memorable experiences possible. Samus's Super debut may be pushing 30, but everything that made Super Metroid great still holds up to this day. The only thing holding Super Metroid back on the Switch is Nintendo's online service. You have to be subscribed to play it at all. If you do go down that rabbit hole, then you've got one of the greatest games of all time at your fingertips. Metroid Dread is a game that had impossibly high expectations set upon it. It's a game in a series that has been mostly dormant for the last decade, a sequel to a game that launched almost two decades ago, and a return to a genre the series spawned three decades ago. There was no way Nintendo and Mercury Steam were going to pull it off, but then they did. Metroid Dread is almost perfect. Hyper-refined controls, super-slick movement, and supremely satisfying combat meld with stellar cinematography, visuals, music, and freedom. It's a triumphant return, and one that should herald a new age of Metroid, providing Nintendo pays attention. That part is always a coin toss.